And you can actually sign up for it very easily by just Googling on the Aspetar webpage, and you just put your email address down and your personal address, and you'll get this sent to you hard copy for free. So there are over 5,000 subscribers, and you can easily do that. But it's very easy to find on the Aspetar homepage. Aspetar Journal is a very easy sign-up page. Just put in your address and it'll start coming to your post box twice every 2 months. And the best authors around the world, it's a great free product. And there are over, Dr. Nebo, 6,000 subscribers, is that right? And our editor-in-chief, Dr. Nebo, who most of you know, Olympic gold medalist from 1972, and our former CMO. Okay, so we've had lots of good feedback about the session so far. You already have heard from Dr. Mohammed Al-Say, who's our Director of Sports Dentistry. He's a visionary in this field, and he's going to take us into more detail on the dental emergency kit. Thanks, Dr. Mohammed.
Good morning, everyone. Today, our sports dentistry department are proud to introduce our new dental emergency kit. The idea of this kit comes to me about after I was wondering how can we assist our colleagues from the club's doctors and the federation's doctors in the events of emergency. And this kit is not a ready-made kit. Each item was selected based on the types of emergency that are most common. And I think that will put our department on the track of Aspetar missions and visions to be a leader in sports medicine. Before we start our presentations, kindly be advised that this presentation is geared to club and federation's doctors who are not trained in dentistry. But I would like to ask our colleagues from clubs and federation's doctor how they can deal in case of there is oral trauma and they have no materials between your hands. Like, for example, this types of injury.
Kietul, Milano, pune capul, fautate, cadu, luat tare, bulgarul, Jivko Milanov, cadu, nu protestează, știe că a greșit. Cartonaș roșu. Cadu este eliminat, repriză de coșmar pentru capitanul CFR-ului. Penalti ratat și eliminare în minutul 42. Jocul se poate schimba radical în favoarea Vasului după această eliminare a lui Ricardo Cadu. Înlocuit bulgarul. Am văzut semnele lui Liviu Antal către banca de rezerve. Oh.
Also, I would like to ask you again how you can manage your athletes if he's complaining from severe pain or sensitivity and there is no dentist available. I think this is the objectives of our quest is to assist all clubs, federations, and national team doctors in the treatment of a dental emergency where no dentist is available. And our kit should be available during athletes' training and or competitions, either inside or outside Qatar. Our kit can be used in case if there is oral injury, in case if there is severe pain or toothache, and also in case of there is a gum recessions or sensitivity. Also, it can be used in case of there is an orthodontic related issue as a temporary solutions. We were going to talk a little bit about it later on. And also, the kit can be used in case of loose or displaced crown or filling. But I'm going now to ask my colleague, Ms. Esther, our dental assistant, about the content of our dental emergency kit.
Hear me? Okay, great. Thank you. I'll start again. Lightweight and complete, Aspetar's dental emergency kit would be a valued addition to your medical bag. This kit measures at about 5 by 12 by 20 centimeters. This comprehensive kit comes complete with an instruction booklet here with everything that you'll need to know about all the items that we have in this bag. Disposable mask and gloves. We have here our Save a Tooth solution, if that camera could come working for me. We have here our Save a Tooth solution inside a kit. Eugenol liquid. Temporary filling material. Desensitizer, dental floss, dental wax, cotton pellets, sterile and non-sterile gauzes, and disposable instruments. Our disposable instruments include a mouth mirror, with a mix-in spatula at the end. We have a probe. We have plastic instruments and cotton plier. At the end of these, they come dual-ended, so we have different sizes of condensers and plastic spatulas for your convenience. Our doctor thought it was great. We have very small ended here. I'll show it to you here. We have one that's very small-ended for any situation. We have your regular plastic here, plastic instrument, and several sizes of condensers here. Ball condenser and all that. Okay.
Also, our kit contains zinc oxide eugenol, and this liquid is used to refine or minimize toothache until you refer your athletes to a dentist. And this liquid, as you know, is used in case of the nerve is exposed or in case if there is a very deep tooth cavity. But there is a special precautions that should be given to our colleagues from the clubs and the federations, doctors. Please avoid the contact this liquid with the soft tissue and ensure the athlete doesn't swallow the eugenol and don't exceed the recommended doses. Okay, so now how you can apply this liquid? First of all, you need to request from your patient to rinse his mouth with the water to remove any debris. Use our disposable tweezer provided in the kit and dip it a small cotton pallet and dip it into the liquid. And then place the cotton pallet directly into a cavity. Monica, please. So now my colleague, Ms. Monica, also, she's our dental assistant. She's going also to show you how you can use the eugenol liquid and how can you apply it into a cavity.
Good morning, everyone. I will be demonstrating the use of eugenol liquid on the patient. As Dr. Mohamed mentioned, the eugenol liquid is used to relieve pain in the case of open dental cavity. I will need tweezers, And I will need the cotton pellet. And I will apply small drop of usual liquid on cotton pellet. I will squeeze the cotton pellet on the surface, so the excess liquid will be removed, because as Dr. Mohammed mentioned, usual liquid can irritate soft tissues. And then I will very gently place cotton pellet inside the dental cavity. Thank you.
Also, our dental emergency kit contain the ready-made temporary filling, and this material is used as a temporary to re-cement a crown also, and can be used to cover the usual cotton pellet until the patient visit a dentist. Again, how can you apply this material? Number one, you have to remove a small amount of the temporary filling material and using our plastic spatula, and then overfill the cavity with the material. Request from the patient to gently bite down. The patient should request it to stop eating or drinking for at least 30 minutes. Okay, Monica, please.
So now I'll be demonstrating the use of temporary filling material. As Dr. Mohammed mentioned, we can use temporary filling material to use, for example, if patient loses his crown, we can place a little bit of filling inside the surface of the crown, and then we can place the crown back, and the temporary filling material will actually work as a temporary glue. Then we can use the temporary filling material to cover open dental cavity like this one. You will need flat plastic and condenser. Okay. You will need to remove a small piece of temporary filling. And you roll it between your fingers into small ball. Okay. And then with help of your flat plastic instrument, you will place the temporary filling inside the dental cavity. And then you can squeeze excess filling material, and you will ask patient to bite down slowly. Patient should be drinking or eating for 30 minutes after.
Also, our kit contains a desensitizer, and that gel is indicated in case of a patient to complain from severe sensitivity, or sometimes your patient complain from pain or sensitivity. Please, you should always don't miss the buccal side of a tooth. And once you do a clinical examination by using our instrument, please always check the buccal side. And if there is like a gum recessions, that might be the reason of a toothache or a sensitivity. There is some instructions on how to apply or to use this gel. Again, you need to request from the patient to rinse his mouth to remove any debris. Dry the area or a tooth with the our gauze in the kit. Place a thin coating of a desensitizer solution directly into sensitive tooth or area. And again, ask the patient to stop eating or drinking for 1 hour.
Included in the kit, as was mentioned before, is our desensitizer. Here we're using ClinPro. And this varnish contains fluoride, so that's a really important nutrient so that the teeth can regenerate, okay? We all know that, so that's really good. So basically it opens from here, just like that. Inside you have a small packet, comes complete with a brush. You'd like to manipulate this packet so you can have an homogeneous mix of the liquid inside. It's very important that you do that. Gently tear across the top. Take your brush, insert inside. As we sometimes do, we just get it out onto something, just like that. In this case, we'll do it like this. We use our brush. And here on the model, usually it's going to be a, you know, by the gum line. So we just want to apply it. It has a very thick consistency. Okay. So we just want to apply it like that. And there's quite a bit in here. It is recommended for single use only. And it can cover several teeth. Okay? Please ask your patient not to eat or drink for about an hour. Okay?
Also, dental floss. It's used to remove food debris from between the teeth and beneath the gum, which can be sometimes painful and uncomfortable to athletes. So now again, my colleague, she's going to show you how to use this material.
Okay, so I'm just gonna show you some flossing instructions, how to use a dental floss. We usually, well, this is a little bit too long. You don't need to floss long like that. We will be using in the middle finger, okay? And your index fingers and your thumbs, that will help you to direct the floss the area you want to go, okay? The main rule is to be gentle. The gum is very sensitive tissue. We will slide the floss with slowly zigzag motions. And we will just follow the shape of the tooth, and we will move the floss along the gum. And we will pull. And then we will do the same thing on the other side. Again, follow the shape of the tooth along the gum. And we will just remove all the food debris from there. Thank you.
Also, dental wax. This type of material used for covering sharp edges of wires or orthodontics applies, which can cut or injure the patient's soft tissue.
And we have a lovely model here to do our demonstration with. For those of you who are familiar, who are not familiar, one of the problems with orthodontists is that the wire or the brackets can be a bit irritating to the soft tissue on the buccal surfaces, or sometimes it will irritate the gum area. And when we find that happening with a patient, the doctor would usually, this is our dental floss that's included in our kit. And our dental floss, I could just have that camera, it comes like this, just several strips. Okay. Again, you can go back to any one of your plastic instruments, and you can just cut a piece of floss. I'm sorry, not a piece of floss, but a bit of wax, just like that. Depending on the surface area that you have to cover, you can manipulate it. It's very soft. And basically, if I can just get the camera on that, you basically want to go ahead and just place it in the area that's irritating. So somewhere, let's say along here. Okay, just like that. And again, if the area is larger than that surface area, you have enough here to cover that until that patient gets to the orthodontist. Okay?
Also to inform you, our dental emergency kit was used this week three times. Two times during the boxing game, and one time for one of our national team football player. And we're going now to listen to one of our colleagues, what he's going to say about our kit. Sorry.
So I'm Dr. Antonio. I'm doctor for the Qatar national team under 23, and we were training on a training camp in Doha, and one of the players just got a contusion with the ball, and he is wearing our braces, so he had soft tissue injuries on his lips and cheek. So at that time, I had to remove the player because he was bleeding. And because we were in Doha, it was easy for me to bring the player to Aspetar, to the dental department, and just solve the problem. The problem was solved just with a simple thing, that wax. The wax is in the emergency kit for dental problems. So I think this kit is very important because, especially when we travel abroad for a training camps or competition, and we don't know the city, we don't know the places, we don't know the dentist, if it's available or not. I think with this simple thing, the wax allow the player to come back and train. So for me, the kit is very useful to take with the emergency kit when we travel abroad, because we can solve many things, many simple things that otherwise we have to send to the dentist, and it's difficult to do it.
Also, we have two different types of gauze in our dental emergency kit. The first one, which is a sterile gauze, can be used to carry a knocked out tooth or to stop the bleeding of soft tissue. And the non-sterile gauze can be used to dry the tooth or area before desensitizer applications, or to carry a lost filling or crown. Also, our kit can be used in case of tooth injury. You have different types of dental or tooth injury. The first type, it's involve only the crown area, and this is easy for you to manage it because it's visible for you when you do clinical examinations. So if you face this types of injury, you can use our desensitizer, and then please refer the patient to a dentist. And of course, it can be fixed. The second types, which is more difficult for you, which because it cannot be seen clinically when you do oral examinations. But this type of injury usually associated with the pain and tooth mobility. And in this case, please, you need to refer the patient immediately to a dental office. Also, the other types, which is called the tooth intrusions or tooth extrusions. Tooth intrusions, in this case, the tooth is partially knocked inside the socket. And in that type, the tooth is partially knocked outside the socket. And in this case, you need also, again, to refer a patient immediately to a dental office. This is also a dramatic type of tooth injury, which is called avulsions. And in this case, the tooth is completely outside the socket or the oral cavity. Let us to see this type also of knocked out tooth injury.
It's always a bad sign. Coats getting put on, a couple of umbrellas up, saying, well, cameramen are telling us there's a bit of rain in the air. They did say that there would be the odd chance of the odd shower.
Straight here, Jim.
We'll just see how this develops over the next two or three deliveries. Oh dear, now that's hit him hard. I'll tell you what, that's hit him hard. And is cutting. And Finn went for the hook shot, but well directed the bouncer. And straight, full on that was. I think he'll be able to get something done there. Ross Taylor's wandered off, he doesn't want any more of that. It's a good bounce, it's full on this. That is full on. I have a feeling there might be some damage to one of the teeth there, as if one came out on impact.
See, now the tooth is completely knocked out.
Doesn't look great. That, I think he'll be having to go a little visit. Get that cleaned up. Helmet has done its job. Imagine what the consequences would have been without it.
John Butler from Morecambe, please go to reception, which you'll find just behind the pavilion. John Butler.
What he's got to do here is take as much time as is necessary to decide whether he wants to carry on. He's most vulnerable for that next delivery. There's a tooth missing. He's going to obviously be in a lot of pain.
Well, the pain will probably come a bit later on, Bumble. At the moment, the adrenaline's pumping. You won't feel too much, but I think that... put it this way, if you're visiting the dentist, I think, try and sort that out at some stage. You'd be reluctant to come off. Players are nowadays. Just physio's got to decide how bad the damage is, but he's certainly lost a tooth there. I reckon the physio will probably want to take him off.
Well, I think it depends on the player. The player himself, he's had a full-on blow. Do you feel that I want to get right back into it now? Yeah, I've got a tooth missing and I'm going to be a bit sore. Does he look groggy? He doesn't actually. He's back up onto his feet. He's having a drink. He's obviously going to go off, I think. Yeah, he's going off.
And I think, in fairness, that makes sense. It does. It's full on, this. It's absolutely full on. Ball just hits the grill and drops. And there you go, it's just stopped. He's lost the tooth there, so generous applause from the crowd here as he leaves the fit. And Flynn, it's up.
So, the question is now, can the knocked out tooth be saved or not? Of course, yes, but if you follow, please, our following instructions. First of all, please try to find the tooth and always try to hold the tooth from the crown. Don't touch the root because that will affect the periodontal fibers and again will affect the prognosis of replantations of a tooth. And then you have different options. The first one, which is the best options, is you can replace the tooth inside the socket and a request from your patient to bite gently on a piece of gauze. This is the following instructions to show you how you can replace the knocked out tooth inside the socket.
Another tooth clean out of their mouth. The tooth has a crown, the bit that you can see when you smile, and a root, the bit that holds the tooth in the gum. If you're unlucky enough for this to happen, try and stay calm. Find the tooth, pick it up by the crown. Don't touch the root, as there are cells here that need to stay alive to save the tooth. Gently try and put the tooth back into position, holding it only by the crown. Bite on it so that it holds the tooth in position and go and see a dentist immediately. Never reimplant a baby tooth.
But if not possible, then the second option, you can request from your patient to keep the tooth between the lower molar area and his cheek, I mean the buccal sulcus area. And at the same time, if you are might afraid, maybe your patient can swell the tooth, then you can place the tooth in a suitable storage medium, like, for example, a glass of milk or in the provided save a tooth solution. And then you need to transport the patient immediately to a dental office. Remember, any delay of the treatment that will affect the prognosis. This is our liquid, which is used for preserving a knocked out tooth. And that, of course, will increase the chance of saving the tooth. The liquid contains sodium chloride, bicarbonate, sodium phosphate, and citra. Please, Monica, can you show us how they can use the liquid?
So Save a Tooth solution is very easy to use. It contains a pH-balanced liquid, which helps to preserve a knocked-out tooth. It can store up to 8 teeth, okay? I'm just going to show you how to place knocked-out tooth inside a container. Okay, wearing gloves, you will be touching the tooth always by white part, enamel part, never by the root. There is lots of sensitive fibers around the root, and they can be destroyed if you rinse the tooth or if you will touch it there. So we'll always need to touch the tooth by the white part. Then we will open the container. And then we will remove sterilized foil or seal. And we will place the tooth inside the container. We need to bring the patient into to see his dentist as soon as possible. We do not do this with baby teeth, only with adult teeth. Thank you.
And this liquid is for single use only. And please remember, in case of the milk tooth knocked out, don't try to replace the milk tooth again, because that will affect the tooth bud of the permanent tooth. And of course, this is our dental emergency contact number. We are available to see all of our athletes anytime, 24 hours per 7 days. Thank you very much.
Facial experience, thank you, training in Chicago and in Johannesburg. So if you think of those cities, you know, we think of trauma and gunshots and very good training for a dentist. So Dieter, welcome to Aspetar, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction, and thank you very much to the organising committee for my invitation today. I was quite honoured to receive that. So where is Perth? Well, Perth is in the west coast of Australia. It's the capital city of West Australia, and it's here. The state of West Australia has 2 million people in it, and the size from Wyndham or Kununurra to Perth is approximately the same distance as going Moscow to London. So we cover a very significant and large surface area, which has some challenges. The lifestyle in Perth, well, one of the things that a busy trauma surgeon who gets their phone calling them every hours of the night and frequently is to go fishing. And I like to go to remote areas up on the northwest coast where there is no phone conversations. You can only use a sat phone and go spearfishing and scuba diving. And these are fishing berths from the local professional lobster fishermen or crayfishermen that we also provide a medical service to, and that's why we're able to go to this region. But Perth has a great lifestyle. Australia has a great lifestyle. We encourage people to come to Australia. The people are quite friendly. And with the spearfishing, you catch fish and you can live quite roughly on the spearfishing docks. And I'm a maxillofacial surgeon by trade. And you know, maxillofacial surgeons deal with infections, facial trauma, cysts and tumours of the jaws, facial reconstruction, orthognathic surgery or correction of facial dysmorphia, and other surgery of the mouth and jaws. But facial trauma for us provides a core component of what we do. And in Australia, you need a medical and a dental degree to be a maxillofacial surgeon, and you do 2 years of general hospital training, and then you do 4 years of advanced training. And where was my interest in sport and maxillofacial surgery? So a long time ago, when I was a young fella, I played water polo for the Australian team. And in fact, Andrea, our physiotherapist, is actually doing a PhD in the Aspetar at the moment. I haven't seen her for 15 years, and I met her in the stairwell on the way up. But on this particular tour, I got my jaw broken in the temporomandibular joint region, which piqued my interest in regards to, you know, training to be a surgeon. And this is one of my crusty mates who I play water polo with. And in Australia, we have an alcohol problem. Young people drink too much alcohol, and we all consider ourselves to be amateur boxers on weekends after consuming too many drinks. And they usually drinks that are this size or this size, and not the size drinks that we should be consuming. And in medicine has risk factors for heart disease, such as high blood pressure, hypertension, you know, high cholesterol levels, you know, smoking, and we have risk factors for broken jaws. In Perth, it's if you're in a bar minding your own business, you're male, you're 16 to 30, you're having a couple of quiet drinks, and there's a thing called a TT ratio, which is your tooth to tattoo ratio. So if you have more teeth than tattoos, it probably wasn't your fault, or you've been taking recreational amphetamines. So next time you visit Australia, make sure that you're not, you can be the most obnoxious and belligerent guy in the bar, because you'll never get assaulted. Now, table of contents. What we're going to talk about is emergency management, anatomy, classification of injuries, signs and symptoms, investigations of patients with temporomandibular joint disorder and injuries, treatment and recovery advice. So moving on to emergency management. So as with any trauma patient, airway comes first with C-spine precautions. There are temporomandibular joint injuries that can compromise the patient's airway, particularly if they're causing a lot of bleeding, and particularly if they're unstable mandibular fractures. So if you have bilateral temporomandibular joint fractures, the bony support of the upper airway is compromised, it will collapse, and you can have obstruct the oropharyngeal airway. Circulatory-wise, you can have exsanguination from facial injuries that can be life-threatening. They're generally penetrating injuries, so not so much common in boxing, more in implement and penetrating injuries. But the maxillary artery that comes around this part of the jaw is a branch of the external carotid artery. It can bleed a lot. It can be life-threatening if you don't know how to manage it. And the standard techniques that boxers and cutmen are very, very competent in doing, because they do it all the time, pressure, local anesthetic with adrenaline, suturing staple, clamping lacerations or bleeding vessels. You can pack the nasopharynx or the oropharynx. Reducing facial fractures at the point of, if they're bleeding, just a simple digital manipulation of the fracture to reduce it will reduce the amount that it bleeds. Interventional radiology if you're in already a centre. And external carotid artery ligation techniques are not really indicated anymore if you're close to an interventional suite. But if you don't have access to an interventional suite and you're presented with life-threatening bleeding, then you have to resort to those techniques. Moving on to the anatomy of the temporomandibular joint. Well, like any form of joint, there are bones involved, such as the temporal bone and the mandible. There are ligaments involved, also including the temporomandibular joint capsule and the lateral ligaments. Cartilage is a fibro-articular cartilage, and the lateral pterygoid muscle attaches to the intra-articular disc. And there's also related anatomy. This is a very complex region of the face. The facial nerve exists in this region, which is important for surgical dissection. That's the nerve that makes you move your face, wink, smile, animation to the face. And the parotid gland, which is one of the major spit glands or salivary glands, is also in this region. And what's the relevance of the anatomy, apart from just going through anatomy? Well, the condyle movement is limited by the tympanic plate of the glenoid fossa and the lateral capsule. The lateral pterygoid muscle pulls on the mandible, so if you break it, it tends to be shifted forward and medially, which can be sometimes hard to retrieve and reduce. The middle cranial fossa is about a millimetre away from this region, so a good decent blow can sometimes piston or ram the condyle into the middle cranial fossa and injure the brain. And the fibrocartilaginous disc has a little capacity for repair, so chronic, multiple, regular injury will result in osteoarthritis of the joint. And in the pediatric population, the growth centre of the jaw joint is the condyle of the jaw. And how do we classify injuries? Well, we can classify them a number of ways. I like classifying them by the tissue type, but you can also classify it by the mechanism. But in terms of tissue type, with bones you consider fractures. For soft tissue injuries, such as a cartilage or disc injury, there's things like effusions or hematomas or contusions or ruptures. And then there's the concept of dislocation that's already been brought up today. In terms of mechanism, well, generally in boxing we come across blunt force trauma, either low or high velocity. But you can also get penetrating injury or perforating injury with implements. And there's a classification system for temporomandibular joints. I like to use this one because it's quite simple, and if you're on the phone talking to a doctor that's going to repair it in a tertiary centre, it's quite an easy way to remember how to describe it. So intracapsular means within the joint surface itself. Neck fractures is just below the condyle of the joint. And subcondylar, which is what we're seeing in this picture here, is between the sigmoid notch and the back of the ramus of the mandible. And what are the signs and symptoms? Now, this is difficult, because if you're dealing with an athlete at a bout, they get punched in the face, they think there's something wrong with their jaw. Does that mean they've got a broken jaw? They may have a number of these symptoms. So it is quite a difficult call to make without the appropriate investigations and imaging. Malocclusion. Generally, when your teeth don't meet together, that's a very sensitive sign that there's something wrong with your jaw. It is possible that your jaw may not be broken after an assault where your teeth are jacked open, but generally it's a very sensitive sign. Lip numbness is also a very sensitive sign. So if a patient or an athlete, after being hit to the jaw, complains of lip numbness, then you need to be very suspicious that there's a fracture. Pain or movement and palpation, well, that's very common after someone's been assaulted. It doesn't necessarily mean anything. Crepitation of fractures, so if you're hearing a cracking or a crunching noise in this area, normally it does transmit close to the ear. That may be something that may be related. And a reduction of the range of movement of the joint. Now, there are two very rare but important signs. If an athlete has hearing loss with this type of injury or a blow to the jaw, then it may be possible that the jaw has been pushed into the middle cranial fossa and injured some of the hearing apparatus. Or if they've got a neurological impairment, like they've been knocked out, they've got a seizure, they've got other neurological signs and symptoms, you need to be concerned that they may have had the temporomandibular joint piston into the middle cranial fossa. And that's shown here where it's pushed through into the middle cranial fossa. And you can see that's the case. So on this one here, you can see where the arrow shows that. Now, what sort of investigations? Well, what can you do? Well, usually when they referred in, there's three types of images that you can perform, radiographic images. This is very much dependent on the size of the facility you work in. If you're in a regional remote centre of West Australia, you may not have access to MRI scanning, but if you're in a big tertiary hospital, you may do. So it's all measured and tempered on where you're actually working, what sort of access you have to these types of tests. But plain film x-rays are very helpful. You can do 3D scans. We use CT scanning. In some instances, cone beam CT scanning is available, but I would recommend you use a CT scan because it's better at looking at some of the other tissues apart from bone, and then MRI scanning. You can do direct visual assessment if you're skilled in arthroscopy. I'm not an arthroscopist, but some arthroscopists do use that as part of their investigation before they treat patients. And then the standard dental assessments of checking people's bites by taking dental models or using articulating paper. Now, plain film x-rays are always a good baseline investigation. So most centres have access to those. Even some sporting facilities have access to those in their treatment rooms. 3D x-rays are great. They do provide detailed bony views, but they're expensive and their availability may not be easy to get to. Magnetic resonant imaging is good for soft tissue and chronic diseases, but probably doesn't play a role in an acute trauma setting. And this is an example on the top right here of a MRI scan of the temporomandibular joint, you can see effusions, you can see problems with position of the disc, and you can see whether there's marrow edema or evidence of chronic inflammation. Whereas on the inferior picture, that's a Towns view that can show that showing a plate on the temporomandibular joint after it's been reduced and repaired. And now, what sort of treatments? Now, treatment-wise, you can treat fractures with either something called an open reduction in internal fixation, which is putting plates and screws on the jawbone, or a closed reduction is where you wire people's jaws together, either with wires or use lucky bands to help guide their bite. In terms of dislocations, there's a particular maneuver that you can apply to reduce the jaw. And in terms of soft tissue injuries, once you've made an appropriate diagnosis, the standard principles such as rest, ice, compression, elevation, anti-inflammatories, and occlusal bite splints are helpful. Now, I've noticed dislocations have been brought up in this talk before. If you are looking after an athlete and they think they've dislocated their jaw, it's a fracture until proven otherwise. If someone can't get their teeth to meet together, without appropriate imaging, don't go tugging on their jaw because it's a broken jaw until you've proven otherwise. And that's an important take-home message. It's rare for a dislocation to occur as a consequence of trauma. It's always a fracture. I've never, ever seen it to be a dislocation as a consequence of trauma. But this is an example of a dislocated jaw where this is the condylar head, which should be sitting back here, and it's come and popped forward. And that's it's shown schematically where the condyle pops forward, it gets jammed because you get some muscular trismus, and it doesn't move back into the glenoid fossa. Now, surgical management of temporomandibular fractures. Not all fractures need to be fixed. Just because someone has a break doesn't mean they need an operation. This is an example of plates and screws. So we put little titanium plates and screws after aligning the fragments. And this is an example of what we call closed reduction, where we put wires around the teeth. Now, the plates and screws are very thin titanium. You can bend them with your fingers. All their role is to align the fragments to allow your body to heal. They don't take up the load of the jawbone, and there's always sometimes some pressure from athletes to say, please offer me an operation because I'll get back to activity quicker if you do, and that's a misnomer. That's not true. Why would we want to open up a joint as opposed to wire someone's joint together? Well, that's usually a very complex call by the surgeon. It depends on the patient's age, if they've got systemic disease. It depends on how cooperative the patient is, if they're going to actually come and present for appointments every week. It depends on their risk of infection. Some patients don't want to accept the risk of a nerve injury. If you have a facial nerve injury and you can't wink and close your eye, that's a problem in terms of your vision. That can cause problems with your vision. Some people don't want to have a scar on their face. Some people can get chronic pain from joint degeneration and they don't want to avoid that, so they may want to have an operation. There are other risks, including comminution. We call it a bag of chips, or crisp chips. If the bones are so badly smashed you can't actually physically put screws and plates in it, then you aren't able to offer them that type of operation. Entering the joint space and entering or stripping the blood supply off the bone can sometimes cause resorption. If the patient has other teeth fractures and they don't have a bite that you need to worry about, then you may not need to fix it. The patient's expectations are also considered. If you're trained and you do a lot of these types of procedures, then you tend to get very slick at it. And also your technological resources to plates and screws may determine whether you would perform this operation. Now, the ones that should get operations are people that have displacement of the temporomandibular joint laterally and the ligaments are damaged. If they have displacement of their joint into the brain, then they need an operation. If there are other foreign bodies, sometimes when people get assaulted with implements like sticks or knives and they're in the joint space, they need obviously an operation. And if they can't open their mouth after a week following their injury and it's a mechanical obstruction, they need an operation. Other indications that are relative ones, meaning that they need to be assessed, whether there's ramus height, which is that length of the jaw, if that's shortened. If there's bilateral fractures in someone who needs other fractures repaired, in someone who's got no teeth and has bilateral fractures, it may be a consideration. And sometimes you can't wire people's jaws together because they're epileptic or they're diabetic or they've got seizure disorder or other breathing ailments. Now, there's a number of approaches that we can use to get to fix the jaw. The open approaches are preauricular, posterior auricular, retromandibular, transparotid, and coronal flap. extension. In terms of arthroscopic, you can stick a scope in the joint, but there's a couple of techniques. There's a single puncture or double puncture technique. Now, this is an example of a posterior auricular scar. The side's a scar behind the ear. This is quite a technically difficult operation to perform. These are examples of pre-auricular incisions. These are the workhorses of our department if we need to get access to a high fracture. This is called a transparotid approach. This is and a retromandibular approach. They're variants of each, but this is also a workhorse of our department. And then a submandibular approach, which is coming inferior up to that area of the jaw. The reason why we pick those is we want to avoid damage to the parotid gland or the spit gland, and we want to avoid damage to the facial nerve. And for high fractures, we usually use the pre-auricular approach. For neck fractures, we use the retromandibular approach or transparotid approach. And low fractures, we use the transparotid approach. But endoscopic approaches are also considered. And with endoscopic approaches, one of the problems with endoscopic approaches, if you're going into the joint space, is you can only go to the superior joint surface. But you can also get access to this area of the jaw. But it's quite technically difficult, and it requires a learning curve for you to be proficient at it. And you need to be doing lots of it. And this is our standard approach and what the patient looks like postoperatively if we need to gain access to the joint. What are the advantages of doing an open fracture? We can see the fracture a lot easily. The patient gets back to function and mobilisation quicker. You don't need to wire their jaws together. And there's less temporomandibular joint chronic postoperative problems. What's the disadvantage of it? There's increased morbidity. You can have damage to the blood vessels in that region, the facial nerve or the parotid gland. There's about a 5% chance that can occur. There's an increased risk of ankylosis or fusion of the jaw joint and also avascular necrosis where the jaw joint shrinks away because you've stripped the blood supply off it. And it's a more complex procedure and takes longer. And in a big trauma hospital where there may be other priorities, sometimes the operating room theatres don't like you mucking around on someone's jaw joint for an hour and a half or 3 hours, depending on how long it takes you, when there's other pressing or priorities within the hospital. And it's more expensive. So plates and screws, an average plate costs in Australia about $160, and there's a $40 per screw. And we need 2 plates and 8 screws worth when you compare that to some wires and plates, which is usually about 10 cents or 20 cents worth of hardware. If you have chronic people who chronically dislocate, then there are procedures you can perform to do that. Or to prevent further dislocation. They're categorised either into ligamentous procedures, bony procedures, or muscular. The workhorses of our department are we do things called an eminectomy or a Doltre's procedure, where we put either a bone graft to prevent the jaw moving forward. But we also have a role for Botox injections, but that's not it's not going to be a focus of my talk for today. And in terms of repetitive soft tissue injuries, which may not be a fracture or dislocation, But the patients are getting assaulted or hit to the jaw and they have effusions or hemarthrosis, then they can develop pain and dysfunction because of degenerative osteoarthritis, which can reduce their range of movement of their jaw. And they could also have internal degenerative disc changes such as adhesions, internal derangements or disc displacements, which can be painful and affect the patient's function. And then in terms of recovery advice, regardless of whether an operation has been prescribed or not, or the technique used, the mandible will always be susceptible to further fractures if it's been broken for a period of time until it's completely healed. So open reductions only align the fragments. They don't make the jaw stronger. It's a misconception. The advice we give our professional athletes, and it's also tailored to the athlete depending on what their income is, their level of profession, if they're amateur or professional, if it's their, you know, their livelihood versus they're doing this outside their primary work. But generally the advice is the same. It's at 4 weeks your jaw is 60% as strong as it used to be. At 8 weeks it's 80% as strong as it used to be. And at 12 weeks it's back to normal. And in my opinion there's no such thing as a glass jaw. And an athlete asks us often and said, when can I go back and box, doctor? And I said, well, you can go back and box. If you think your jaw, if you're going to get hit, it'll be weaker up to the 3 month mark. And I said, well, when can I go back and box? Am I going to break my jaw? And I said, well, only if you don't get hit, you won't break your jaw. So that's a risk that the individual athlete takes. We just provide them advice and they can make their informed decision from that. And some athletes, if it's important to them, are prepared to accept the risk of refracturing at 6 weeks with a 20% chance that it may do that because it's got another 20% recovery to go. And that's their informed choice. And these are examples of an open reduction. So here on the left-hand side, you can see subchondylar fracture and we've got two titanium plates and screws reducing it nicely with the appropriate alignment. This is an example of a closed fracture. This patient's got two fractures, one on each side, and we've got some wires around their teeth and we've wired their jaws together. In terms of post-operative recovery, in terms of fracture advice, we usually advise the athlete to avoid contact for 4 weeks and then gradually ease into full contact at 6 weeks. This is for a professional athlete whose livelihood depends on it. The jaw at 6 week will still be weaker than it normally would be up till about 3 months. For the first 4 weeks, they can still participate in cardiovascular training and skill work to preserve their fitness, because they may have concerns that their fitness will drop off. But they should avoid exercises where jaw clenching is required, like Smith's machine, squats, those sorts of things. In terms of redislocation advice, the main problem is a tendency to redislocate. So the patient needs to be mindful of extremities of jaw range of movement. Sometimes the soft neck collar is very helpful, or a turtleneck. It just reminds the patient not to open their mouth too wide for about 24 to 48 hours after their initial reduction. And it's the same advice that we're going to give and talk through in terms of the soft tissue injury. And in terms of post-injury management for soft tissue injuries, the acute management principles for someone who's had the injury and you want to manage them for the next couple of weeks are, they're patients that will suffer from a fusion or a hematoma or a concussion or a rupture. And the main problem is, you know, you want to avoid long-term arthritis in the joint. If the athlete's experiencing pain in the joint, that can be distracting to them if they're trying to focus on their opponent. They can continue to participate in competition contact sport with this injury. We usually try to advise them to avoid jaw contact until their symptoms resolve. We offer them a soft diet order and non-steroidal anti-inflammatories. And sometimes blight splint therapy is considered, or having their occlusion or bite fitted to their mouth guard is also very comforting. It can make the athlete feel more comfortable. In the injured patient that has chronic soft tissue injury, the end stage treatment for someone like this who can't open their mouth because they've got an osteoarthritic joint is temporomandibular joint replacement. There's an example of one there. Obviously, that's something that we offer patients at the end of their careers or their contact careers. It's not for someone who's actively engaged still in contact sport. But there are other surgical procedures that can be offered, which is endoscopic procedures like arthrocentesis, arthrotomies, or arthroscopy. But there's not a lot of high level of evidence based or around those procedures to assist internal derangements of the joint. And chronic management principles also depend on the presentation of the patient, but you know, physical therapy, pain management in a biopsychosocial model is helpful, and occlusal splint therapy or bite splints at night time can be helpful in relieving symptoms for patients. And the future of any sports are obviously the next generation. This is my son and my wife, who I've left behind in Perth. My son is 6 months old. I was a keen swimmer. One of the advantages of the Australian sporting system is we have swimming lessons for kids from 3 months old. So here's my son learning to float on his back. And I bought him a hockey stick. I noticed that, and the look on his face when he picked that up, God help us for his next opponent. But I'm happy to take questions in the break, and I'd like to thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you today.
Hospital. but before that at Hamad Hospital, but in between, a very considerable stint in the UK where he trained both, he's got accreditation from the College of Surgeons in Edinburgh and also the College of Surgeons in Glasgow. So we look forward to hearing from Dr. Talal. Thank you very much for being here.
Good morning to everyone. I'd like to thank everyone, especially who came from outside, for attending this event. And I'd like to thank Aspetar for organizing this nice work as well. I'd like to talk a bit about the surgical management of mandibular fractures. My previous colleague talked a lot about the condyle segment of the mandible, and that's very helpful because it takes away a good segment of my talk and relieves me of doing that, so we'll crack on with the rest. Just a bit of introduction about what exactly is a mandibular fracture, why it happens, basic biomechanics of mandibular fractures, surgical approaches, surgical technique, and just a touch about complications management. I will not go in details about surgical approaches. I will also not go in details about how you manage certain unusual cases. I'm going to keep it a simple adult basic fractures, something relevant to boxing, for example. So why do jaws break? Statistics are different from place to place around the world. There are places where you get personal violence, like I trained in the UK, for example, and personal violence was top on the list. Most fractures we get through the accident and emergency departments are through weekend drinking, basically. Whereas if you come to our part of the world here, the story is completely different. And road traffic accident is the major dominator of all trauma. You also have the sports injuries, and you have lots of other reasons like falls and funny scenarios like that. For this guy here, during boxing, he realized that if you put your belt up on the head, you're not going to get any bumps at all, so he decided to put his belt up. So what is the objectives of bone surgery, any bone surgery, not just the mandible? You need to put anatomy back right. You need to dissipate load and take it away from the fracture site to dissipate it evenly on all the bone. And you need to make sure that stays on until you get full healing. So the same thing applies for mandibular fractures as well. You need to restore anatomy, you need to restore function, and you need to restore facial aesthetics. The internal fixation devices that we have today also should make sure that they stay undisturbed and they can withstand all the loads from chewing and normal function without, ideally without having to wire the jaws together as people used to do in the past. So just to talk a bit about the mechanics of the mandible. Which one is the pointer, sorry? This is a standard model for a mandible. During function, we have two areas of dissipating the power. One causes tension at the level of the occlusion, and one is a positive compression at the lower border. We also have another important issue, which is the muscles around this structure, and we have the hyoid muscles, for example. We have the masseteric muscle and the pterygoid muscles. The effect of these muscles will basically try to lift the ramus part up and try to bring the body with rotation downwards. So with the effect of the facial muscles, for example, this is the effect you get with a fracture. You get compression at the lower border, and you get tension splaying at the upper border. This is not all. The story gets more complicated with another issue at the front, where we have this turn or this horseshoe shape. The effect of the muscles here will cause a torsional rotation, which means that the two parts of the body will rotate around each other. Right, so how do we fix fractured jaws when they happen? Well, first of all, we have to schematically, if I go back again, we have to schematically look at the mandible in sections. So classification of mandibular fractures, for example, based on the anatomical part of where the fracture happens, we're going to divide the mandible into the anterior segment. The anterior segment starts from the mental foramen here. So it's between the two mental foramens. And then we have the body of the mandible until about the gonial notch. And then we have the ramus, and we have the condyle and the coronoid process. Thank you. So, at the beginning of time, when people wanted to start treating those, it used to be very simple, just putting patients into intramaxillary fixation. And that basically means an arch bar on the top, an arch bar on the bottom, and elastics in between. Now, in a biomechanical term, this is called tension banding, where they realize that the upper border is the place of tension, and that's the place where it opens. So basically just put a bar across that and hold it together. And then things moved on into fixation, trying to fix them. Not all the patients, even at that time, used to get away with just arch bars. So some of them used to need something more, like external fixators, for example, or halo frames or things like that. So before the antibiotic era, closed fixation was the normal thing. People never used to get in at all. And then when they found that not easy or not feasible, they would go into a halo frame, for example. And then things, of course, moved on, and they started having the antibiotics, treatment of these, the fear of infection started going away, so people started getting more and more courageous into opening these things and having a look inside and trying to reduce them anatomically. So first generation that came through was basically just opening and putting wires around the jaws. There's lots of different techniques with that. Some people use lower border wiring, and some people use just buccal cortical plates wiring or upper border wiring. There's 101 different ways of doing it. Things moved on further, and then the AO standard started coming through. The AO standard talks about putting plates and screws. The initial description of these things, and as I believe AO standard is still practiced around many units of oral maxillofacial surgery around the world. Initially, the idea was to put two plates, one at the most unfavorable site of the fracture, which is the lower border, and then later on they realized that this was not enough in itself, and they had to go into putting another one on the upper border as well. These plates are dynamic compression plates, so they have strange looking screw holes. They are not straightforward, where you find the inside of the screw hole smaller than the outside of it, and that guides where the screw moves. I will talk later on about how exactly that's done. So when you want to apply the AO principle, you still have to have the tension banding idea. And for the tension banding, you can still either use just an arch bar or you can put an upper border plate. This is just to give a quick idea about the AO plates, the AO compression, dynamic compression plates. And they have different directions of the screw holes. These screw holes would be able to, if you put the screw inside, it slides towards one side. And by doing that, it enables control of the segments where you put the initial one to bring the segments together, and then you can put the second one to open or close the segments as you have the situation in your case. Later on came the SORG approach. This is by far how I was trained in the UK, and this is all my work. I rarely ever use the AO plates. I use the mini plate principle, which is done by the Strasbourg Osteosynthesis Research Group. This was founded in 88, and more or less it became, in many places at least, the gold standard for treating mandibular fractures. This was all based on the Champy principle. And if you take a model of the mandible, according to the SORG group, this would be the best place to put the plates. So again, if we remember our classification of intra-foramini segment or anterior segment, in the anterior segment, we need to put two plates in a subapical position. The idea of the two plates is to stop the torsional or the rotational activity. Going back to the body, then one plate was, which this is a mini plate. This is a unicortical plate, not a bicortical plate. Again, perhaps I missed mentioning that for the previous system, the AO. The AO started by being bicortical plates. It engages the full thickness of the mandible. In this system here, we only have small screws which go through the cortex, one at for angular fractures, one at the external oblique ridge, and for body fractures, one at the body would be enough. How do we approach mandibular fractures? Again, pretty much as my previous colleague was mentioning about condylar trauma, it depends very much on where your fracture is. If your fracture is in the anterior segment, for example, you can go through a laceration in case of trauma. You can go through the standard approach, which is an intraoral approach. You can go submental. There's 101 different scenarios, and it's the call of the surgeon case by case to decide which is the best one to use. The standard approach we use for intraoral, intraforamini fracture or parasymphyseal fractures, as we call them, is an intraoral sulcular approach. This is the same used for body and for angle. This has become the workhorse of all mandibular fractures, basically. You cannot, however, treat everything using the intraoral approach. There are some scenarios where control of the flail segment becomes a bit difficult, or basically your fracture is situated in an anatomical area difficult to access intraorally. So there are some extraoral approaches to help you with that as well. Namely speaking, we have the submandibular or a high submandibular approach, the Risdon approach. We have a facelift approach, a Risdon, which is a preauricular, and a standard submandibular one. I'd like to add, of course, that there are other situations where you can use arthroscopy, for example, especially when you gain access to the condyle. Some ramus fractures need either an arthroscope sometimes or even a basic transbuccal approach. And the transbuccal approach is an intraoral standard approach, but from the outside, you just make a little hole and you put a trocar through that. And that takes you right through to the angle of the mandible or to the ramus. You can even treat some low condyle fractures or low subcondylar fractures using that approach as well. This is an X-ray taken from the museums of history, where you have two screws used at the front or the anterior part to control a symphyseal fracture. I've not used that ever, and I haven't seen anybody who's used them before. But it used to exist as a way of applying internal fixation. And this is the old, I'm talking about the AO principle of putting one at the lower border and one at the upper border. This is the compression dynamic plates. Moving on to the SORG approach, and this is a standard unicortical mini plate and the unicortical mini plate. Again, at the beginning of applying this principle, people used to think that you need two plates to be able to control fractures, whereas right now, of course, we know that this is not the case. Most of your standard angle fractures can be easily controlled by one. And this later on became the standard of treatment, which is a one external oblique ridge plate. I personally don't use that technique. I use a body spanning a plate placed transbuccally. I never go into this. Anybody who works in surgery, Professor Lars, for example, knows very well that this can sometimes be awkward to bend and takes some time, whereas the other one is easy and can be done in 2 minutes. This is a case of an angle fracture on the right side. The angle fractured through the existing wisdom tooth, which again, I mean, I put up this slide just to take into consideration teeth in the line of the fracture. What do we do about teeth in the line of fracture? Basically, teeth in the line of fracture will depend very much on their situation. If they have any infections, for example, obviously they will pose a risk, and it's better to get rid of the tooth. If it's a sound tooth, not broken, and it's not coming in your way of putting your fragments together, then I suppose you might as well keep it. Sometimes keeping the tooth is a bonus because you can use the tooth itself to put a wire through around the tooth and the one on the other side of the fracture. And by doing that, you can control movements of the segment as well. In this scenario, I did put two plates. The reason why I put two plates is after I had done my first plate, which has a big internal space here, I noticed that some movement of the lower border continued to exist, which is not ideal really for during masticatory loads and everything, so I decided to go ahead and put another plate. Sorry? Yeah, it is. It is. Two holes at the back and one at the front. This is the same X-ray taken in an anterior-posterior position, in a PA skull position. And this is to show that the ramus of the mandible is very symmetrical with the other side, and there is no problem now. Going back to the issue of the tooth itself, I did get rid of the wisdom tooth here, and most of the time, wisdom teeth impacted, I just get rid of them anyway, be it infected or not, because they do come in the line of fracture and they come in the way of putting the segments together. Another case where this was a part of a polytrauma scenario, mandibular fracture, maxillary fracture, zygomatic fractures, and even a nasoethmoid as well. That was not luckily due to boxing. It has nothing to do with that. That was a road traffic accident. And this was treated by, going back to the idea, tension banding, but this serves a lot more than the tension banding here. The idea of using it here was to actually treat the closed treatment of the fractured condyle on the right side. The symphyseal fracture was treated by a standard intraoral to Champy-type subapical miniscrew fixation. There are scenarios when the situation is not that simple. It is not just a line of fracture that needs to be put together. You may open up to see many lines of fracture, and of course you should know that before you open. Here, again, you have a call between treating it as a bag of chips, or and by doing that you need to just apply arch bars and closed fixation, or you can proceed to, sometimes depending on how the fracture, what the fracture looks like exactly, how big the segments are, you may be able to go and treat it by applying internal fixation, and that can range anywhere from putting a large plate that spans the whole mandible, which is done and done at many units as well, or you can go and put multiple mini-screw or mini-plate fixation like I did here. You can always argue one advantage for this technique and one disadvantage, and one advantage for the other technique and one disadvantage. Now, that's definitely easier than applying a large reconstruction plate on the whole mandible. It can be done easily through an intraoral standard approach. It doesn't need an external scars or anything like that. But at the same time, unfortunately, the price to pay is putting a few pieces of foreign body. And we know very well that the more pieces of foreign body you add in, the more possibility of infection you may face in the area. In this scenario, I had to put a selection of different techniques, an upper border wire to control the segments at upper border. I had to put also screws at the bottom to be able to put a wire around the screws and contain movements, flail movements at the lower border. Separate segments had to be wired through a buckle, a cortical wire, and finally a two plate spanning the two fractures. There are special scenarios. Not, as I said, I will not go into details about how you treat children with mandibular fractures, for example, and elderly with mandibular fractures, or edentulous people with mandibular fractures, but just a quick touch. When you do not have teeth at all, or very few teeth, the reference becomes, the loading becomes directly on the alveolus. Also, the body of the mandible will atrophy bit by bit and lose height. And that will mean more forces of the muscles can actually apply on the fracture line, and therefore just adhering to the normal standards of Champy, putting one plate, for example, on the body is not going to be enough. I did have, when I was in the UK, a guy I treated at night without telling my or telling my boss exactly how my treatment plan was. I applied one plate on each side, and then after 1 week he came back to the clinic with something called the bucket handle phenomena, where the anterior part of the jaw is turned down. So you just cannot do that. You have to apply either bigger plates or multiple smaller plates. This was a funny case of a fracture in the ramus of the mandible down here, and another fracture, or you could say a comminuted ramus fracture, where it involves one in the subcondylar region and another piece separating from the ramus. These two, unfortunately, I don't have a pre-op x-ray, but these two were quite flail, and that segment was opened in a really funny way. So we talked about doing an approach to the ramus and an approach to the condyle where we're going to treat both. The patient did not agree to treating the condyle because he did not like the idea of facial nerve palsy, even though it was explained to him that the chances are low, the possibility is not that high. It does exist, but it's not that high. He said, is this the only way of treating it? And I said, no, we can treat it closed still, and he opted for that. So what I did was I went in transbuccal, and we put a vertical plate, which is ideally according to the load distribution. That's not the ideal way of putting the plate. The ideal way would have been to try to span it forward rather than vertical. But anyway, I went in and put that plate between the top and bottom segment. I left the condyle sagging down there. That's the start of the treatment. So that was the segment that was joined to this. The condyle was left sagging, pretty much inferior to its placement in the glenoid fossa. This x-ray was taken a year on, and it shows a full healing of that segment, and it shows how the condyle here is trying to remodel. Now, funny enough, during that time, the patient did not have any of the classical signs and symptoms that you are expected to have when one part of your joint is not working. Basically, he's just depending on function based on the right condyle, not on the left condyle at all. And still, he was not opening with deviation. He was opening full range, and his occlusion was very, very acceptable. Now, taking that x-ray later on, one more year after the second x-ray, and it shows an almost completely healed condyle, which you can distinguish from the old situation from his previous x-rays taken before that accident, as the condyle is located slightly anterior to its original place, but that was it. He was maintaining absolutely full function. Just a quick mentioning of how you manage complications of mandibular fractures. Now, this is, again, a subject in its own right. It is not something that you can talk about very quickly. To give a brief outline of this, a complication would basically mean that you can either have infections or you can have a non-union of the bone fragments, or you can have simply malunion, where you have some of the fracture is healed and some of it is granulated and causing repeated infections. Now, in general, the outline of treating that would be to place the patient on a slightly long period antibiotics. By long period, I mean we're talking about 12 to 14 days. Opening up the mandibular site, removing all the hardware which you have placed in. If you find the segments not healed at all, so the mandible is still moving, then you need to put arch bars and put him into closed reduction. Ideally, you would need to wait for a period of time until all the healing is gone, and then you need to assess whether you can put larger plates on or you need to actually do bone grafts as well. Normally, when you have a complication or malunion or fracture, the ends will not heal together and they'll be full of granulations. So you have to remove all these granulations, spare the nerve, and put the bone graft in. Thank you very much. Thank you.
May as well take you
the USB, yeah?
Thank you very much, and congratulations to all the speakers for doing an excellent job of keeping to time, and sharing fantastic information with us. You've heard from Dr. Elijah Anderson already this morning. And in this talk, he's going to focus on the soft tissue side. So we've come from a couple of great fracture talks to soft tissue. Lars, and congratulations on your textbooks. You saw that he's written three substantial textbooks, massive amounts of work, and great to have his wisdom with us in Doha today.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's getting close to lunch, so I will not get over my time. We're talking about the soft tissue injuries now. Okay, we are focusing on soft tissue injuries, and you remember that this was very, very common and frequently occurring in among the injuries we see in boxing. As high figures as 75% of all injuries have been mentioned, and among these, lacerations and contusions are the most common of these injuries. But we also see abrasions and tissue avulsions with boxing. I will repeat very, very shortly these four classifications that we perform with soft tissue injuries. These are some examples. Contusion is when the soft tissue is hit, and it doesn't necessarily mean that the underlying bone is fractured, but that can be an indication of that. You can find such injuries deeper. And this is more or less what is happening in boxing all the time. You are hit and you are bleeding internally, the swelling and edema will come. So it's a lot of contusion in boxing. Abrasion injuries are more rare, but are seen in boxing. And you saw the colleague here showing that you can get scrape injuries, abrasion injuries from boxing gloves, actually. Lacerations is when we not any longer have an intact surface, but cut into the tissue. And the tissue avulsion we talk about when a part or the whole soft tissue is lost. Let's take them one by one now and relate them to boxing. Contusion, this is caused by a blunt trauma, and boxing is a blunt trauma all the time. Edema and hematoma in the subcutaneous submucosal tissue. But the skin is always intact on the surface. We see swelling and bruising and bleeding in the tissue, but the area, the surface area is intact. This is very painful on palpation. And this is how a boxer most often looks like after a match. There is no treatment necessary if the injury is limited to the soft tissue. Hematoma has to be controlled, and hematoma is usually controlled by itself. When the pressure opens from the surrounding tissue, the bleeding will stop. But a contusion injury clinically may indicate that we have an underlying bone fracture. And we usually go to a radiographic examination on these cases, and this may reveal fractures in the skeleton. We also see contusions intraorally, and when they appear in closer relation to the mandible, it's almost pathognomonic for an underlying mandibular fracture. So don't forget to look inside the mouth for soft tissue injuries also. The area affected in boxing is most commonly seen around the eye, and it's a hematoma underneath here. It can be quite extensive swellings. And after a while, the boxer cannot see any longer. And I was happy to hear this morning that matches are stopped when this happens, because if you cannot see, you will be an easy victim, and the match is therefore stopped. Ringside treatment is about applying pressure and applying ice. And these bleedings, deep bleedings, they stop spontaneously, but it happens. If a vessel is bleeding and continue to bleed, that aspiration or even exploration have to be considered. The hematoma usually breaks down during the first week after trauma, and the situation normalizes, or with a connective tissue build up and scar tissue, this will be partially permanent. Ear contusions can be quite severe. The cartilage is covered by very, very thin skin, and if we have a contusion here with the bleeding and swelling, this is very, very painful. There's a risk for necrosis of the pressure built up here, and that can result in deformation of the ear. And the ear can be deformed, and that's called cauliflower ear. I was happy this morning to hear that this was seen much, much more often before than we see today in boxing. But the risk is still there, and there are many boxers who look like this after some time. Scarring, bleeding, organizing into connective tissue will result in this, and usually repeated trauma, new trauma with new matches. Abrasion injuries, we heard a colleague mention that the boxing gloves can cause such injuries. This is a very superficial injury caused by rubbing and scraping of the skin. It doesn't look very serious, but there are some important things to consider. The bleeding in this area, although very superficial, will expose nerve endings, and it can be quite painful for the patient. Often we see dirty small particles, dirt, dust, or even sand, and it's very, very extremely important to remove these. Otherwise, there can be permanent tattooing in the skin. When you see a patient like this, it's very important to clean and put in a lot of efforts doing this. You can use local anesthesia and a soft toothbrush, and all foreign bodies should be removed. That's very important. And this must be done in the emergency situation, a few hours after the trauma, that is after the match, and it should be done in the emergency situation. Otherwise, you may end up with permanent tattoos in this area. This is a patient where it certainly took half an hour to really get clean and get rid of the dust in these abrasion fissures. This is what happens if you do not clean this in the emergency situation. You will have a permanent tattoo in the lip, which is very aesthetically unpleasing. Laceration injuries were the most common injuries we see. And I suspect that we will have a little under-reporting here, because contusions are there all the time during the whole match, but is seldom reported. Whereas when there is a cut, it's seen, and it takes a lot of effort to stop this. So that is observed and registered. I suspect we have a lot of more contusions in boxing, but if you read the literature, there is more lacerations. They can look very different. It can be an incision-like wound. It can be crush trauma. Or it can be that the skin and the soft tissue around the chin is torn away in a flap-like laceration. All these injuries, laceration injuries, are subjected to bleeding. And as we heard a previous speaker talking about during the matches, some of the matches are stopped if the bleedings cannot be stopped. And that sounds very, very good, because there may be bleedings that can be quite troublesome from this highly rich vascularized area. It's important to inspect the bleeding side and identify the bleeding source. And usually compression is what is needed, and time. And during a boxing match, you don't have time, because the next round will soon start. And if we had more time, like one of the previous speakers mentioned, by having several cutmen, they could have more time to stop the bleeding. But if you don't have time enough, there's a risk that they will not be able to stop the bleeding in the pause between the rounds. Identifying the bleeding source is important to see if the case below is a dental injury, luxation injury, or from the lip. A few words about lip laceration. Although these are often caused by teeth, and often we see simultaneous dental injuries. I found it a little bit strange because many of these boxers today, they wear a mouth guard, but I suspect there are, and we saw also in the statistics, that there are people who do not use the mouth guards. And then, of course, there's a higher risk for dental injuries. And when you see a laceration injury in combination with a crown fracture, you can you must search for the fragment, and this one is often found in the lip. Radiographic exposure on the lowest time will reveal if there are any such fragments in the lip. And all these foreign bodies must be removed after the match, the hours after. Otherwise, this will require this will be quite scarring, scar tissue and scarring healing, and which may require plastic surgery afterwards if it's not dealt with in the emergency situation and all the time after. It's wise to look at if the lesion is non-penetrating through the lip or if it is a penetrating lesion. It's simple to close a wound. If it's a non-penetration, it's simply cleaning it very, very carefully and placing a suture. Whereas the penetrating lacerations, you must really work from two ends and clean the whole tunnel and everything very, very carefully, and suture from two sides before you can leave this. A few words about eyelid lacerations, which are very, very commonly seen in boxing. And sometimes they are in a combination with orbital rim fracture. And in some more rare cases, even with a complex globe injuries. So when there is such an injury, we must really suspect the worst until the opposite is proven. If this is not dealt with early, it will be aesthetically disturbing, loss of symmetry, and dysfunction of the area. So careful evaluation is very important, and that's of course clinically, radiographically, and surgically done. Lower lid lacerations are seldom problematic, but in the upper eyelid, we have the lacrimal gland to take into consideration, and we don't want tears to come out in the wound. They should drain the usual way, and you must make sure that you can deal with them. Sometimes it requires an opening up to make sure that the structures are in the right place. How do we close wounds? There is a debate, and has been a debate for several decades, whether we could tape these laceration injuries, if we could glue them with tissue adhesive, or if we should suture them. And I will go quickly through the pros and cons for these. Surgical strips are used mainly to decrease tension and cover suture ends. We seldom rely on them as the sole way of closing the wound, but they are excellent for relieving tension and covering suture ends. They can be used alone if you have a low tension areas, but the whole facial region is full of tensions, and it's seldom that we rely on this in the facial area, whereas you can do it on other parts of the body where the tensions are not that high. Arguments for tissue adhesive is, of course, that this can be done, if it worked, very, very quickly. Just put glue in the wound, hold it together, and then leave it for healing. It's less pain because you don't have to give any injection anesthesia, no scars, and comparable actually aesthetic results to suturing. The substance they use is the cyanoacrylate, and this has been approved for use in the United States in recent years. Often we combine these things with strips, as I said, and sutures in different layers. Tissue adhesive we can use sometimes, but it's controversial in the lip region. We have a high risk for wound adhesions, and the lips are actually mobile and in areas with tension. Going to the literature, there are comparative studies, tissue adhesives versus sutures, three studies I found, and concluding that comparable aesthetical results between tissue adhesives and suturing. But note here that no lip lacerations were included in these studies. In other areas of the body you can possibly use this, but not in the lip lacerations. There are two Cochrane database review, Farion and Paul Coulthard, done this, where they have gone through the literature and found that we have comparable aesthetics, like I said, and infection rate, but significantly more deficiencies with tissue adhesives. So we can conclude that there is not enough evidence at present for recommending tissue adhesives in the high tension areas, and the high tension areas we have in the oromaxillofacial region. So we stick to sutures in most of these cases. You know that we can use absorbable sutures or non-absorbable sutures. What can we choose? There are arguments for this and that, and there have been some studies looking into that, and they have found no significant difference. It seems to be more important to choose the right thickness or thinness of the suture and a material that you are familiar with. Three studies have looked into cosmetic outcome, complication rates, and satisfaction, and there is no significant difference. What we choose usually is for the deep cutaneous layers, is absorbable, simple interrupted sutures, 4-0 or 5-0 in most of the cases. In the skin, we use absorbable or non-absorbable sutures, and these are thinner here, 6-0 or 8-0, to achieve good aesthetical results. The simple interrupted suture is what we use, and we are all familiar, most of us, with using this technique. And it's not a bad technique. It gives some more stitch marks for each suture placed, but properly placed, they can be used to close lacerations. However, there are other techniques like intracutaneous suture. It's also called intradermal, subcutaneous, or subcuticular suture, where you hide the thread inside the tissue. You end up with two stitch marks and not maybe 12, 13 stitch marks after this. And this may be of value in aesthetically sensitive areas. The principle is to go in to the tissue and the suture, so to say, inside the wound. And then you stretch it out, and they are easy to take. Just pull it after some time. This is a case I use this technique, and you can hardly see the stitch marks. And when we take this suture, it's a good aesthetical result. I mentioned about the ear injuries, that these are very, very sensitive areas close to the cartilage. And here we also use thin sutures if we have to do suturing here. It's also important to press away the hematoma, because if you have a hematoma building up, you have the risk of those cauliflower ears. And this is a very, very tricky area, very, very difficult area. We have made some progress, so we must understand the mechanism behind this. What's happening here is that the venous drainage is compromised, but the arterial blood is maintained. And this is an imbalance, and it leads to coagulation and filling up with blood, hypoxia, increased pressure, and the risk of necrosis. So we would ideally have something here that could aspirate the blood, keep the blood thin, and avoid or delay the coagulation. And that has been the dream for many. And recently, interesting but disgusting, I must say, techniques to do this is using leech therapy, in a chamber you host leeches, and these creatures, they draw off the blood. They inject an anticoagulant, hirudoin, and they also release antihistamine and hyaluronidase. And this is exactly what we are aiming at, if we could dream a little bit to do it ourselves. But these creatures are doing it for us, and there is promising research about this. So possibly in ear injuries, this is what to do in the future. But so far, it's research and first clinical trials on this. So don't go home and buy leeches. Timing of repair is important. We know that if we have an open wound, it will grow bacteria there, and this will increase by time. After 2 hours, we have 100 bacteria per gram tissue, and this increases very, very rapidly. Five hours, we have 1 million bacteria per gram tissue. And when we pass 100,000, it has been estimated that there's about a 95% chance of the wound being infected. So we have a critical load of bacteria. You see from these figures here that if we can have a low number of bacteria, healing is almost always uneventful. But if we have more bacteria, we will have an infection. And infection is very much related to time. So if we can get these patients in as soon as possible after trauma, we can avoid infection. We are happy in the facial region that we have a rich vascularity. So for us, we have up to 24 hours, really, where we can see healing without any infection. Should we then use antibiotics? That is discussed and has been discussed in many years. It's difficult to start such studies, but I guess this is what we need to put an answer to this question. There have been some studies on this, they conclude that when we see penetrating lesions into the bone or through and through soft tissue, there is some evidence, but very low, for use of antibiotics in such injuries. But when we just have non-penetrating lesions that just open up, there is no really statistical difference in post-operative infections between using antibiotics or not. In these studies. So the evidence is weak. We must also remember that it's not only a question about bacteria. You can also get compromised healing by other reasons. For example, if the tissue has been mishandled or is dead or been traumatized extensively. If you have foreign bodies there, it will delay healing. Or if sutures are left too long. We also have patients with diabetes, arteriosclerosis, smoking, and the abnormalities in the immune function system that also run a higher risk. Tetanus prophylaxis, we should always think about that when we are dealing with a laceration. This has been before associated with outdoor injuries, and they of course have a highest risk, but Clostridium tetanus spores can also has also been reported also with indoor injuries. So as soon as you have a laceration, you should ask about the tetanus protection. And if it was more than 10 years since the last immunization, consider a booster dose. We have come to the final of the soft tissue injury, the tissue avulsion. And that is when you lose a part of the tissue. And that has also actually been reported in boxing. I don't know how he managed to bite off this ear with a mouth guard, or doesn't he use mouth guard? I don't know. But this is a typical example of a very, very rare injury in boxing, but it has happened, and a lot of publication happened around this case. But I don't think we will see many such injuries, hopefully. They are rare, not only in boxing, but also in the society. And the things we have to consider here, if we lose much tissue, is if we should try to close it by sutures or if we should not try to do that. And that is because if we don't do, if we don't close it or and leave it open, we will have scar contractions. And for this, if we have large injuries of tissue loss, we may consider to use local flaps or skin grafts to avoid this scar contractions. So it's always a decision for the clinician. This is one of my patients, a young boy who lost the front part of his lip. And I was, this is a bicycle accident, it has nothing to do with boxing. But here I really discussed with myself if we should do it in this way or the other. However, given that he was a young age, we decided to give him a chance. And this is how he looked half a year later. Young people have a wonderful regeneration capacity and can regenerate. But if he would have been 25, 35 years old, I don't think it would look this satisfying. So it's an individual choice. Once again, I remind of the books where all I have said is written there for those of you who are interested in this. I thank you very much for your attention.
Everyone, we're going to reconvene in 1 hour. So at 1:30 on the chart, we'll start. Just start moving up to 1:25, please. We're going to reconvene in 1 hour sharp, which is at 1:30. So please start coming up from lunch at 1:30.